Welcome to the Broken Metatarsal, where we celebrate everything that naughty's football had to offer. My name is Rich Williams. Joining me today, Planet Football editor Mark Holmes.
All right.
We're good. Planet Football deputy editor, who initially muted the WhatsApp group for this podcast and then didn't bother turning up for an episode. So I'm not sure whether we should be taking the hint or not. Rob Conlon.
It's still muted. I'm just waiting to get tagged in. That's it.
The only way you respond to anything is if we at Rob Conlon on the group and then you respond to it.
And that's always the least important chat as well. I know my place.
And our special guest today is a Liverpool supporting comedian whose website simply says, "Hello, please buy tickets to my tour. Thank you." It's the incredibly polite and well-mannered Alfie Brown. Welcome.
Hey, yes. If anybody could heed that advice, that would be absolutely fantastic.
Yes, don't just read it. Go ahead and actually book the tickets as well. And before we start anything, is the Broken Metatarsal, we ask all our guests, and this is the first time you've joined us on the podcast, whether they have any connections to metatarsals other than owning them whatsoever, whether they've had a broken one, an injury to one, or been to a football game where a player has had an injured metatarsal. Can you throw anything into the party?
I have nothing to offer. Although when you kept on saying metatarsal just then, I was trying to unpack the etymology of it in my brain, and it led me to the query of what a tarsal is, because of course, meta is to carry, as in a metaphor, you carry the meaning of a word for. So a tarsal, you must be carrying. Is it are you the tarsal, and these are the bones that carry
you along?
Yeah.
I mean,
I already feel like we're on a different level.
This is the most highbrow start to any podcast
we've
ever done.
Dent on.
What is it? If anyone would like to let us know, contact at planetfootball.com. If you know what a tarsal is, there's a sentence I never thought I would say. Each episode, we dig into one element of the noughties. From the sublime to the ridiculous, today we look at one of the biggest single-season trophy hauls of the noughties, when Sammy and Stephane stood firm at the Kop, Gerrard's glorious emergence, majestic Gary Mack, Owen Fowler, and a team that would be twice crowned in Cardiff, only to cap off their domestic success during a ding-dong night in Dortmund, where they were destined for European divinity. Take yourself back to the opening main season of the noughties, when Liverpool did the treble.
Trying to reach it. Owen! One chance, one goal, one very, very special forward, and Liverpool are back in business thanks to Michael Owen. Owen stretching his legs and getting away from Dixon and getting his shot away. That is just absolutely fantastic. He has won the cup for Liverpool all by himself.
McAllister into the middle. Liverpool win it with a golden goal. It's 5-4. An unfortunate own goal though, and Liverpool come out as winners.
So there you go, the year that Liverpool did the treble, 2000 into 2001. And Alfie, when you sort of look back and listen to commentary and relive that, how does it initially make you feel?
I because of the age I was when in the year 2000-2001, I have a very different way of viewing these years, in that my reactions are a lot more emotional and visceral. That I don't remember the kind of narrative of games, but more the narrative of myself watching them. And I think the semi-final of one of the cups was against Tranmere. I was watching on one of those portable TVs with the aerial that I'd opened my dad's the window on my dad's Ford Sierra, not to brag, and it was poking out, and we were going somewhere. I can't remember where we were going, but I was desperately screaming at everything to go our way, and it did.
We have an interview coming up with Stephane Henchoz, one of the sort of main defenders in that season, who we spoke to, and I mean, Mark and I spoke to Stephane, who has firstly, just got the most lovely French accent, albeit Swiss, but you know what I mean. but he's just got the loveliest. Well, they sound the same. They sound the same. He speaks in French. Just
doesn't
lovely.
Matter. Now we're out.
We need another Brexit reference. It's too early.
Well, so is Switzerland. To be fair, they're actually a good example of how to flourish outside the EU.
Just a high level today.
I'd like to thank you both for digging me out of that slightly awkward hole there. Stephane Henchoz, who was just lovely to speak to, and. He's coming up later. And also we have Football Facts or Football Fiction. If you're new to the podcast, or Alfie, you will all have three statements about this season. It'll be for me to work out which is the true one, the fact from the footballing fiction of the season. But if we just go back to the start of that season, Mark, the background, Houllier and the season before and the lead up to what was going to be probably a more memorable season than Liverpool fans could ever have wished for.
Yeah, I think that's fair. I mean, I think when you look back at Houllier's early signings, obviously he'd had the spell as joint manager with Roy Evans and then taken over by himself. And his early signings were pretty horrific, really. And although he'd signed some good players going into this season, he signed a lot of bad ones. And I don't think people would necessarily have seen what was to come. You know, Jean-Michel Ferry was his first one. Freud Kipper, Rigobert Song, Jimmy Traore, Eric Meyer. You know, they're not screaming.
Sean Dundee. Please don't forget about Sean Dundee. Because everybody always forgets about Sean Dundee.
I have forgotten about Sean Dundee. It doesn't even ring a bell with me.
The weird thing is that when we signed Sean, because it was loads of these players that were all signed for about £350,000 from Reims or Mont Blanc in, you know, wherever. We're out now, it doesn't matter. I don't remember his names right, as we've already mentioned. And I got so excited about all these players coming in. Sean Dundee, I remember, was one of the first players to have white boots and a shaved head. And he looked, well, something about the aesthetic of the man suggested to me that he was going to be fantastic, that he was going to have be a really kind of good, gnarly creator, a short and vicious man to stand behind the strikers and lay on a lot of goal. Of course, I don't think he ever played football. Liverpool. He just sort of hung out. Like Bernard Diomed and lots of these different players who I always thought, oh, this is sort of sounds exciting. But of course, it never was.
The actual summer leading into the season, you mentioned one of them. He also signed Greg Vignal. Biscan was one that season. Ziga, who didn't particularly work out.
Biscan was great.
Really?
Yeah.
He wasn't. Really?
Well, I have great memories of this.
Nick Barmby, again, you know, not massively worked out, but he also signed Gary Mack, Babel, who made a big difference, and obviously you've got Hippier, Honcho, we've mentioned, Smeets, Vestervald, who'd come in. So the basis was there, but I don't think going into that season, correct me if I'm wrong, Alfie, you would have gone in thinking, you know, special season coming up.
I think I was excited by... I was definitely excited by Christian Ziga. I was definitely excited by Jari Litmanen when he came in. And Litmanen was the disappointment. A player that always had lots of quality on the ball but didn't affect games in quite the way that you'd want to. Christian Ziga, I have great memories of, but I can't... this is the weird thing about remembering seasons like this, is because I remember him being great against Roma, and me sitting and watching that on a 14-inch TV and going nuts because it was the only TV in the house that could receive Channel 5. I remember.
I love your intricate details of the actual TVs that you watch each game on, which actual TV it was
all
on.
All of these kind of vividly remember these different rooms that I watched these things in because they were such...
And the humble brags keep on coming.
Yes, a Sony 14-incher. And it's from corner to corner. That's how you measure a TV. It's not the width. You always think it's the width. It's not. It's corner to corner. That's how you measure a TV. Listen.
It's much easier in the square days of TVs, wasn't it?
Yes.
So no, we didn't see it coming.
We didn't see it coming. That's exactly what you asked.
But when you look back on that season, there's obviously the three cup finals, which we'll come on to in a moment. But at what point did you start to think, oh, this is turning into a pretty good season when special things were happening? Were there any games that really stood out in that season that you thought, oh, yeah, I quite like the look of this team?
We beat Man United twice in the league that year. That's something you don't easily forget. And also throughout the season, the emergence of Gerrard as a even in those shaven-headed days, you could still tell he had a very pronounced forward-facing hairline. and he scored when we played the at home to United. It was an onslaught. I seem to remember from the word go. We displayed the ferocity that in the years to come he would embody, and he drove the ball. Hard into the net, and I remember spanking my walls with delight. And then there was the Danny Murphy free kick that he got on the edge of the area. Was that the same one where Gary Neville sort of tried to play volleyball with it?
Yeah. Catch it like that.
And then he put that away. And I put the newspaper clippings up on my wall of Danny Murphy reeling away a victory at Old Trafford. So there's those two games, and generally the emergence of Steven Gerrard and the goal he scored at Southampton from about 50 yards. I mean, look it up, YouTube it. It's absolutely.
You're the one with a tablet in front of you.
Well, I'm telling the listener. I've seen it. I saw it this morning. And Gary Mack's free kick against Everton in the final minute. That was a big, explosive, unforgettable for generations to come moment. And also, a great cheat, Gary Mack.
Yeah. That was 150 yards, wasn't it, that free kick?
Yeah, that was.
Behind the goal.
I think he scored that from Elland Road.
I love Gary Mack. I just love, you know.
Yeah, it is quite painful looking back as a Leeds fan at this, because, you know, Gary Mack's 35 and a free transfer and absolutely brilliant. And you look at the way Carragher and Gerrard talk about him. And I was looking at an interview with Carragher, and he says, if ever a player was made to play for Liverpool, it was Gary Mack, which is an incredible compliment. And then you think, why did Leeds let him go like 5 years earlier? We could have had 5 years of him.
We had a pretty good
brilliant
season that season, though, to be fair. Oh,
and actually, well, were the architects of the most painful of Liverpool's fixtures in the league that season.
You got in there first rather than letting us bring
it.
It would have come. But
The 4-3 was, I think, the most. I remember the goal going in and sinking and feeling very dejected, and it just looked like such an incredible moment. Didn't he start like humping the pillars and stuff, and Leeds fans were trying to get off with him?
Just to remind anyone who take this opportunity to remind anyone, we are talking about a 4-3 victory at Leeds over Liverpool at Elland Road, in which Leeds were behind at least once in that game. I'm pretty sure Viduka scored all four goals. So if you score four goals against Liverpool in a 4-3 win, I think you can go and hump whatever you want, can't you?
I certainly don't admonish humping. I can see on my iPad he scored one in the 73rd and one in the 75th. So yeah, and that's what was very painful, is going from victory to defeat in a matter of minutes was absolutely horrible. Especially because I think at that time it meant it had quite bad ramifications for us in the league and what it meant for our season. And
lovely celebratory podcast. Well, I mean, this is what the Liverpool fans have come
well,
for.
Well, I'm building in narrative. We're sinking. This is act three.
Yeah.
You think it's not going to come good, but then at the end, little does everybody know, we actually win the treble.
You mentioned Gerrard and the emergence of Gerrard. I mean, we've discussed before that I don't think there's anything better than watching a player become great for your club, but especially when they're your own player. That is what everyone wants to see, when your player, lad, steps up to the plate and takes your team on to something special. They're at the forefront. That is the best feeling as a fan, I think.
And I think there's certain characteristics that the city of Liverpool as a civic collective embodies, and or at least would desire to embody. And he has those all in abundance. As with Carragher, Carragher is always my personal favourite, but for reasons that I think I identify more with somebody without the specific talent, but with hard work can really make something go for them. I don't think I was had anything God given in the same way that Gerrard and his enormous thighs for a teenager.
I have to say, all the podcasts, we wanted to do this episode in series one, actually, and couldn't because the bloody guest was too young and didn't remember it. But I went in a proper YouTube rabbit hole the other night, watching more so than any podcast we've done, watching clips of this season. And I've never felt more nostalgic. The baggy shirts, which we spoke about last week, but Gerrard in particular, I don't remember him being so gangly. He was really gangly, and he had this like an ugly beauty to everything he did. He was brilliant, but it wasn't refined, if you like it. And like Alfie said before, he was just smashing everything. That goal against Man United you mentioned. There's a Barnby header from that season as well, where he seems to be about 100 yards in the air when he gets it against Everton. Honestly, it was a good hour spent.
We'll mention some more of the players in that squad, because it was a great squad. But if we just talk about those finals, you know, the three finals that lead to the silverware, where were you watching? Did you get to them? What was that like? Who did you watch it with? I'm always fascinated to know where people have watched something.
Well, I've already established it. The only TV in the house which you could watch him on, the 14.
The only TV in the house.
None of these but for finals, the finals were on Channel 5.
Of course.
I think the Carling or whatever. What,
Worthington, what, a proper sponsor.
Was it Worthington?
The glory days. Yes. When men were men and we drank pints.
The Scruttock's old dirigible cup final. I think I had to go to a friend, ask a friend of a friend or something, whoever had Sky, and I had to go around and watch it. And I remember being incredibly underwhelmed by the Worthington Cup final, because we should have won.
It was against Birmingham, so it's not, you know.
And we made it go through to penalties, and there wasn't really too much glory in narrowly beating a much worse side. It was nice to have done it when we did it, but it's because it's what should have happened that you didn't feel elated by it. However, in the it was a League Cup final a couple of seasons hence against United that was really felt brilliant. But I was talking to my friend last night about this on the phone, because we were debating, sorry to talk about the current day, whether or not you'd prefer, you'd prefer to win the FA Cup than to go unbeaten in the league or to have the maximum points total. You go, well, not really. I'd prefer to win the FA Cup if we scored a last minute winner against United. But I'd prefer in the league if the FA Cup final was just going to be a 2-0 victory against Wigan or something.
It's the manner of it.
It's the manner of it. That, it's a game of moments.
And actually, the only thing that makes that, and we speak to Stephane Henchoz about this, you know, which you'll hear shortly, but the only thing that makes that kind of semi-interesting is the fact that he gives away a penalty, which leads to an equaliser, which takes it through to extra time and then penalties. Otherwise, it's just a kind of drab, not that exciting in the grand scheme of things, routine Liverpool win, right?
Does Stephane still have lovely rosy cheeks?
He was on the phone, so I don't know.
No.
Someone on Twitter made a great point about him, that he just constantly looked knackered. His entire life.
That's his rosy cheeks.
Yeah.
Yeah, he absolutely looked like he couldn't manoeuvre. But also, it's the weird thing about footballers from this era. Like, you talk about Gary Mack, and how old was he when he was at Liverpool?
35.
He can't only have been 35. Because 35-year-olds do not look like that anymore. He looks about 57 years old. Yeah. His spine had started to curve. I mean, he looks so impossibly old. But what a player. Players did look older back then. I don't know. Maybe it's the time. Maybe it's the work people are having done.
The two other finals come fairly close together, don't they?
Well, I remember the FA Cup final was at home, and that still felt like FA Cup final day, and it was still something that was fun and that you felt so excited to behold. And when the BBC did 98 hours of coverage before the game, kind of going over, the FA Cup final in 1973 was good, wasn't it? And everybody talks for too long and runs out of things to say.
Has he mentioned that one on purpose? That was Sunderland 1, Leeds 0. Just whether you'd pick that one on purpose for the benefit of Rob and myself, or whether it just randomly came into your head.
I would be, and I would love to be the kind of football fan that it knows the... Did you remember that?
I know of it, but to be fair, you could have said any year in existence and something bad would have happened to Leeds. There'd be some kind of national shame attached to it.
Well, I'm glad you're not that vindictive anyway. Randomly picked 1973.
I randomly picked him. I apologise for triggering you. I remember watching it, both my mum and my brother, and at the time, I felt quite relaxed early on, Arsenal being the better team all the way through the game. Robert Pires scored, didn't he?
Yeah.
And that made perfect sense. And I thought, well, it's good that it's 1-0 and not, as it should be, something more.
Was it not Ludenburg? Don't mind me.
Oh, shit, was it? You're right.
I think it was.
It was Ludenburg, yeah.
I think so.
It was.
Yeah.
It was.
Sorry. No, you can do it again. I just didn't want to.
No. Say it's Ludenburg, and I'll be wrong, and everybody will be very pleased that they're listening to something real. Pires Ludenburg. I mean, that's an easy mistake to make.
Yeah. It was Freddie Ludenburg.
They're easily exchangeable in my mind.
I do agree with that. They are
Arsenal's wide midfielder. I mean, also, I always changed up Petit and Vieira in my brain as well. Yes. So when Owen did what he did, and I mean, it's always slightly kind of disrespectful to the effort of a whole team to describe something as a one-man victory, but it wasn't even a one-man victory. It was one facet of one man, or two facets, speed and finishing, and the same goal twice. It was the same goal twice, wasn't it, basically?
One was a swivel in the box, like someone knocked down a corner. And he swivelled and fired it.
Like half volley, is it, doesn't he?
Of course, yeah.
The second one's phenomenal.
Yeah, the second.
It's like the solo goal, and then he does the little front flip, doesn't he?
Yeah, yeah,
which is
great. Yeah, it's really good.
He was just heroic at that point.
He was, and he'd been out for ages with his devastated hamstring injury. So to still have that pace and to be able to do that, and in that quite nice yellow away shirt, it was a great day. And the Alaves I recorded on VCR. I actually put some sellotape over the little recording bit.
Yeah.
And stuck that in so it would record, and got home after my sister's birthday dinner and watched. And that was absolutely fantastic.
Sorry. You agreed to go out for your sister's birthday dinner and not watch the game live?
I think at this period in my life, as a 12 or 13-year-old by this point, for my sister's 13th birthday, stepsister, be the same age, it's like the Brady Bunch. bizarre upbringing. And confusing to go through puberty with somebody who you're not a blood relation with. Anyway. I mean, you can forgive me for not remembering the Michael Owen goal, because I really was focusing on other things.
Imagine humping as well.
Yes.
I'm slightly worried now.
No, don't be worried. I'm just a very...
visceral man.
Yeah, very sexually charged human being. this is why I need to talk about football so much. To kind of
please continue.
Adrenaline out. Sorry, you're going to have to cut all of this. Anyway,
Gary McAllister.
So I watched it from my bed and... Yeah, I mean, what an incredible game. But with finishing with the... And that felt slightly anticlimactic. Finishing with the own goal that he sort of headed backwards. Yeah.
And a golden goal.
And it was a golden goal as well. Yeah. I do like a golden goal.
I like a golden goal.
But they didn't know. Well, they kind of knew, but they had to be... cajoled into, you know...
Like the Cricket World Cup final. Yeah. And they also had to remember the rules to know whether or not they'd won. Yes.
But I did like that. I think the problem with the golden goal, presumably, is because everyone was like, great, next goal wins. And then after a few, everyone was like, well, wait a minute, don't concede a goal. That was the issue with the golden goal, wasn't it?
And then they tried
the silver one, which was to half time, right?
Which is just the silver goal was one of the most appalling things that's happened.
Yeah. That was absolutely ridiculous. But yeah, it was a golden goal victory.
Yeah. Yes, and I had to kind of keep it very still and quiet in my bedrooms. The rest of the family were asleep, and there was lots of different children, all of corresponding ages, male to female. It really was like the Brady Bunch. But yeah, no, I remember being giddy with joy. And then I think when Saturday Comes, my magazine came in the post, and there was a satisfying cover that emblemised the glory and satisfaction that I'd felt.
Up on the wall?
That didn't go up on the...
Didn't make it.
No, that Dan Murphy's stayed. No one not caught
that. What a nod to Danny that is. You know what? I'm going to keep you up there, mate. Yeah.
Yeah. And I really liked Danny Murphy for some reason. Again, I think I liked him a lot because he was sort of in and out the side until the age of 23. And I thought, oh, maybe it's okay if you don't. And, you know, in the midst of all my expulsions from different schools, I thought, oh, yeah, maybe it's okay if you're sort of shit for ages.
And things will turn good in the end.
Things will turn good in the end, if you believe.
Yes. Rob, when you look at that squad, Rob, who are the players that you sort of pick out and you think, yeah, great memories.
Well, I've got a little bit of a guilty confession to make. So I was only seven at the time of this season. I think I turned seven on the League Cup final. And I wasn't massively into football at this time. I was probably into like Power Rangers for far too longer than I should have been. But
are you over that yet?
Not really, if I'm being honest. But I wasn't really considered myself a Leeds fan at the time. So if anyone asked me what team I support, because my favourite colour was red, and my dad would just not have Man United, quite rightly,
mentioned
in the house, I would say Liverpool, which I'm kind of feel quite bad about. But that was basically because the only two footballers I knew were Michael Owen and Robbie Fowler, who Michael Owen that year, as we've said, he was just absolutely outrageous. And you forget how young he was as well. And he was just this incredible, like, he was England's best player, so I loved him.
Can I just say, before you continue about those players, that's quite unfortunate as a now Leeds fan that the season you did decide to pick to support Liverpool was the season that Leeds did the double over Liverpool, including that Mark Viduka four.
Well,
that
was a turning point. Like I said, I knew nothing at the time of Mark Viduka scoring four goals, really. I knew Michael Owen played for England and scored lots of goals. It was like, yeah, I like that guy. Robbie Fowler as well. And funnily enough, the only time I got tagged in the group WhatsApp recently was a question asking what name I used to go by. And it was actually Robert, but when I was a kid growing up, I was known as Robbie. So I just, again, assumed Robbie Fowler was a brilliant footballer.
Which he was.
Which, yeah, he was. But that season's kind of weird for him because he was, he scored 17 goals. He scored in two cup finals. He won three trophies as captain for a few of them as well. And you think that's an amazing season. But it's weird now looking back that Emil Heskey was so good that Robbie Fowler couldn't even get in the team. And also his two cup final goals, they should be winners, but then they concede a stupid penalty to Birmingham, and it was an amazing goal he scored in the final as well. That like dipping ball.
That's a great goal.
So good.
That was in
the League Cup, and then in the UEFA Cup final, he comes on and scores the goal to make it 4-3. So again, you think perfect. That's like a fairy tale finish to the season. Robbie Fowler, the local hero, coming on to score the winner, and then Jordy Cruyff scores an equaliser or something like that, and it just kind of pisses all over the bonfire.
When, as I say, I was down the Liverpool YouTube rabbit hole, my main takeaway from that was Sander Westerveld was absolutely shit. Mm. Every goal that went in against them in a crucial moment, that Jordy Cruyff one, was he was just like beat to a cross and Jordy bloody Cruyff heads it. he was pretty bad. But that's a great point. Like Fowler, not even first choice striker, he was back up, he got 17 goals. Owen got 24, Heskey got 22. And this was like a team that was accused, as I remember, being quite negative, a little bit defensive, because Julio would play centre-halves at full-back and things. They scored 127 goals that season. That is absolutely ridiculous.
Yeah, I mean, they played about 300 games.
Yeah, they played 63 games, 25 cup games, but 127 goals. That's absolutely incredible. And there's just drama in every single game, like in the finals, wasn't there?
I seem to remember Robbie Fowler in that season being visibly less mobile than he had been, and because he was coming off the back of a shit of a knee injury.
Yeah, he blamed that injury for sort of ruining his career, basically. Yeah. And again, he was still really young, really, when he got it. Like him and Owen were so good at such a young age, and then because of injuries, it just kind of petered out.
He looked visibly sort of out of shape. And Emil Heskey, that was such an exciting season, and that's one of my first memories of a kind of big signing. I think it was when did we sign him? I think the year before, it was like 11 million or something. And him against Derby, when he gets that hat-trick, and I think debuts his crap DJ celebration. he just looked absolutely unstoppable, so powerful and quick. And I can't really remember ever seeing a player, having seen a player like, I mean, I'm sure there were players like him previously, but he was the first one of that type, of that pace-power combination that I can really remember. And a really satisfying thump into the top corner against Derby. Really taught the ball a thing or two about being a ball.
Well, he scored 22 goals that season. Owen got 24 and won European Player of the Year. Emil, he should have been in with a shout.
Two goals away.
I know, two more.
Was that Owen's Ballon d'Or season?
Mm. Yeah. Yes.
Before we hear from Stephane Henchoz and what he had to say about that season, I do want to ask the question, because it was mentioned in the WhatsApp group when we were talking about this podcast that someone wanted to mention a dildo. And I was like, you what? So who would like to take the dildo?
That would be me.
Okay, go for it.
So the story is, it goes to the UEFA Cup final in Dortmund against Alaves, and it's such a crazy, crazy game. And I think it's 3-3 at this point, certainly in the second half anyway, because Robbie Fowler's warming up to come on, and Gary McAllister's taken a corner, so he's warming up sort of next to him. And they just hear this thud, hit the ground next to them.
A satisfying thought.
and Gary Mack turns around and sort of looks at Robbie Fowler and goes, "Is that?" And Fowler just goes, "Yeah, that's a massive dildo." And Fowler flicks it up with his right foot and volleys it with his left back into the crowd, and he says it's the sweetest connection he made all season. but I was just researching this again before.
Imagine that flying towards you, hurtling towards your speed.
It's gone to a part of the crowd where it hasn't come from. So for context, if you've thrown it, you might expect it to come back. But if you're in a slightly different area, no context to just a dildo flying towards your head when you're holding a pie or whatever they've got over in Dortmund.
I was looking back at this just before we came here, and we tweeted something out about it 2 years ago or whatever, and I've only just seen it out. But someone replied to us with a picture of the fans outside the stadium with the dildo. And I mean, to be fair, I'm not surprised it made a thud, because it's like the size of my arm. I'm not even kidding. It's massive.
Robbie Fowler, when he's not finishing himself, he's helping other people.
Okay, more on the way, including football fact, football fiction. But first, let's hear from one of those defenders who made such a contribution and such an important partnership in that treble winning season. Here's what happened when Mark and I caught up with Stephane Henchoz. So much for joining us on the Broken Metatarsal. It's lovely to have you on the podcast.
No problem.
When you look back at that 2001 treble winning season, what are the first things that come to your mind? There must be some amazing memories for you.
Yeah, well, obviously, winning three trophies in the space of, 2 months, it's just something incredible. You know, probably the win over Arsenal in Cardiff in the FA Cup final is the first thing who comes into my mind, you know, when I look back.
And Stephane, to win any trophy, you have to have a good defence. You also have to have a good keeper. It turns out you could do both, as we found out in that final.
No, definitely not. I always get the stick, you know, from the Arsenal fan and the famous handball. I was in a way lucky because probably now with the VAR today, the referee would definitely have taken a look.
Hardly touched your arm, Stephane. Don't worry about it, mate. Hardly touched it. Wasn't going in the goal or anything like that in an FA Cup final.
So that's why, you know, sometimes in life you have to be lucky. And that's football, that's part of the game. And I was lucky myself, because that would have been a penalty and a red card. And at the end of the day, would have been a problem for the team as well, obviously. It was quite early in the game. So yeah, I always get the stick for that. But these things happen.
If there are any Arsenal fans listening right now, be nice. Be nice to Stephane if you bump into him in Starbucks or whatever. Buy him a coffee. It was a mistake. He didn't realise what he was doing. It kind of helps if you've got a Michael Owen up front as well doing the business and putting away a couple of goals in the last 10 minutes, doesn't it?
Of course, Michael, he was on fire all season, you know. So he scored so many great goals, vital goals. And it wasn't different in that final, scoring two great goals. Especially the second, because he nearly scored by himself. He passed Adams and Keown, and with his left foot, Seaman as well. So he made the difference on that day.
Did you think, Stephane, at the start, because in your first season at Liverpool, you hadn't won anything, the team hadn't won anything. Gerard Houllier signed some good players that summer. One in particular stood out for me, Gary McAllister, who I thought was a great signing for you. Did you feel going into the season that you had a good team and you might do something special?
Yeah, we definitely had a good team. And remember joining Liverpool in 99. We had a couple of good signings. We did okay in this season. And we could feel that Gerard Houllier was building a strong team. We were getting better and better. I wouldn't say that I could imagine winning, you know, before the 2001 season. We would win so many trophies. You know, I would lie if I would imagine that or say that. But we knew that we could compete. Definitely the target was to finish in the top three. Then obviously you have the cup, and the cup, it's always a big chance for silverware. As the season progresses and the cup, you know, we are progressing in the cups. We took each game, you know, when it was coming, and we ended up winning three trophies. But before the season, I could not ever imagine winning so many trophies.
If we talk about the League Cup, like if we take it sort of in the order in which they came, We're going to have to do something here, Stefan, that Mark opposite is not going to enjoy whatsoever, because he's a Stoke fan. Stefan, so if I mention Stoke, he's already laughing. Everyone's laughing at you, Mark. If I mention that was, that was, of course, quite a big win. Was it? How many was it, Mark? Was it on that game?
It was 8-0. And I don't know if you remember this, Stefan, but I was there that night, and I will swear blind, we should have been 2-0 that night. So Peter Thorne hit the post and Kyle Lightbourne missed a sitter. Peggy Offexed was in
goal. That's correct. Yeah, but I remember this game. It was a cold night at Stoke.
A cold night in Stoke. That's a surprise, isn't it?
Yeah, yes. No surprise. Going to say that. But it's one of these games. After all, you realize it was an important game. It wasn't an easy game. Obviously, after the game, you think, it was easy, something like 8-0 and stuff, but it wasn't. I think we started poorly. We could have conceded goals, but then we managed to come back in the game, and we did play well, and the game was progressing. When you win away at Stoke, like I said, difficult game, it gives you confidence. I remember, I think, we played 3 or 4 days later against Charlton at home. We won 3-0 and get 2 clean sheets. And it was like, a starting point in our season. So that's why I think this game against Stoke was important, very important.
A good job for Mark over there that you started the game slowly. Otherwise, it could have been how many? I mean, 8 with a slow start, mate.
Yeah.
And the final itself at Millennium Stadium, which became a very happy hunting ground for Liverpool. Even that, I mean, you were... obviously really involved in the action there towards the end. I guess when you give away the penalty and Birmingham get back into it at that point, you're probably thinking, oh, what on earth's happened here? What was going through your mind at that point?
It's always difficult, when you concede a penalty, when you are the one who made a mistake, like I made a rash tackle, should have stayed on my legs, but it's always easy to say it after all. It was a game we should have won before going into extra time, really. Birmingham, playing the championship, they were good opposition, but, I thought we were better. And then we had to go to extra time because, like I said before, made a mistake. Things happen. And then even in the extra time, we had two or three different occasions they could have scored as well. So we had to go to penalties. And I can tell you that you pray, you really pray before the penalties that you are going to win, especially when you are the one who made the mistakes and you could make your team lose the trophy. So fortunate for me, we managed to win on penalties.
We'll come back to the final in just a moment, but there's so much to talk about because there's so much achievement in that season. But just going back to that first trophy, the League Cup trophy, when you win the first piece of silverware, what was the feeling? Can you even sum up the feeling, both for you individually and as a squad and for the city, exactly what it was like, that moment where you've done it, you've won?
I think it was very important because Liverpool didn't win trophies before this one for, I wouldn't say quite a long time, but for a few seasons, for a club like Liverpool, not winning for a few seasons, any trophies, it's like nearly a big drama. So it was sort of relief that even it was only the League Cup, we could win something, and it was already in February, end of February, when we won this trophy. It was a good achievement. We had won something. Everybody was happy. But we knew that the season was far from over.
I guess one of the amazing thing about those 3 finals as well is the drama in all of them. There weren't sort of... Some finals just pass by and they're kind of neither here nor there, but these were all packed with drama. The League Cup one going to penalties, the FA Cup we've spoken about, and then to top it all off, right at the end of the season, it couldn't have got... It was a bit ridiculous, to be quite honest with you. Yeah. The UEFA Cup final in Dortmund, 5-4 against Alaves. It is just... a mad game. You're cruising at one point at half-time, 3-1 up, really.
Yeah.
And then suddenly 3-all, 4-all. There's red cards. Yeah. There's golden goal. I mean, golden goal. just an incredible game of football. What was it like to be involved in?
That's probably one of these classic games. I remember before the game, before the final, people were saying it will be the most boring final ever. We knew that we were quite strong defensively. We were not taking too much risk, and Alaves reached the final more or less by playing the same type of football. After winning the FA Cup, we played this final 4 days later in Dortmund. But I must say we were quite confident. We played Alaves after beating Barcelona, so I think we had reason to be confident. And after 15 minutes, we were already 2-0 up. So it's a bit like it was too easy. If I remember on the pitch, you know, when you start the final after 15 minutes, you 2-0 up, you think, wow, that's quite easy. Then they score. We still managed to score the 3-1 before halftime. And when we came back in the dressing room at halftime, you know, spirit was high. We had more or less the feeling nothing can happen. We can score when we want. Is it maybe a bit overconfident? Maybe. I don't know. You know, sometimes.
It does sound a little bit, to be fair, Stefan, the way you're describing it.
Yeah, from
a
yeah.
We can score when we want.
I don't know. You know, that's really the feeling of this first half when we're on the pitch at halftime. Even the manager is going to remind you, and that's what Joe did, be careful the first 5-10 minutes because there will be a reaction from Alaves and all that. You listen, but, you know, human beings sometimes, you need to remember. And that's exactly what happened. After 15 minutes in the second half, they came back 3-2, 3-3. And then we were a bit shocked because we were not, you know, really, we are not ready for that. Fortunately, we still managed to score. Robbie, if I remember, 4-3. Then they came back once again, 4-4. And it was extra time once more. We knew everything could happen, especially because this rule, the golden goal. You know that you cannot take too much risk because one mistake and the trophy was gone. And we know what happened, this free kick from Gary Mack, and he went straight in. I don't think every player realized straight away we won the trophy because we're not used to win it by this rule, the golden goal. So it probably took a few seconds to realize. Yes, we score, but we can celebrate really straight away. We won the UEFA Cup.
Now, talking about celebration, Stefan. Now, you had been bought off that game early, hadn't you? As Gerrard went for the win. Now, I presume that was just tactical, yeah?
I must admit, at the end of the season, the tiredness after playing so many games, it wasn't my best game to be honest with you.
I noticed, and it was a big Premier League game a few days later, the last game of the season. I noticed you didn't play.
Yeah.
Did your celebrations get a little out of hand that night?
No, to be honest with you, not that much, because we played the Wednesday night in Dortmund, and we were playing again Saturday afternoon 3 o'clock kickoff at Charlton. We couldn't really celebrate much, like we did, you know, after the game in Cardiff against Arsenal. We had a meal, everybody together with the wife and girlfriend once again, and then everybody went to bed, because once again, this game against Charlton, in a way, was maybe the biggest game of the season. It's a bit ridiculous to say it's only Charlton away, but we had to win to qualify and finish third in the league.
Stefan, thank you so much for joining us and reminiscing about. I mean, it can't be too much hardship for you to reminisce about winning 3 cups in a season, can it? But really, so nice to speak to you and to find out a little bit more about that treble winning season. And thank you for being a part of the Broken Metatarsal with us.
Thank you very much.
There you go, the thoughts of Stephane Henchoz. Anyone else regretful now in hindsight that we didn't ask him about the dildo situation?
Good point, yeah. We should have really done that, shouldn't we?
You also owe Pete, who was on some of the podcasts and is currently pressing buttons for us at the moment, an apology.
Yeah.
It did turn out on the WhatsApp group that the phone call to Stephane Henchoz, he was abroad at the time. So how much did it end up costing me?
Like 38 quid.
38 quid for us to speak to. He's going to get that. You're going to pay him back, right?
We'll see. There's negotiations ongoing.
lots to kind of deconstruct, really, from that. The thing that I found really interesting is that despite, you know, we're talking about this podcast, it's about the treble winning season and three cups, but actually their focus the whole time, it wasn't really on the cups. It was, we've got to finish third. That was the goal for the season. And even when they win the League Cup, it's like, great, but we still got to finish third. And even the FA Cup and even the UEFA Cup, they've still got this game against Charlton and they've got to finish third. That was the aim for the season.
It wasn't confirmed until the last day of the season against Charlton, was it? And we won 4-0. And I remember the celebrations with each goal that went in absolutely going off. You could see how much it meant to them. And I can sort of understand that because the Cups are a, you know, that's as well as you can possibly do in each one of those competitions, obviously, is winning the thing. That's why it exists. But to move up a level, to kind of graduate, to get into a competition that they weren't previously in, was obviously, you know, it's obviously what the owners want because it's where the money is. So I remember that. And there was another good When Saturday Comes cover about that, which was all of the Liverpool fans climbing on each other's backs going, almost as good as Arsenal.
Not a chance of knocking Danny Murphy off the wall there, is it?
No. I just took umbrage at it.
Do you still have a Danny Murphy poster on your wall?
No, I've got the Guardian cover from the Champions League victory last year.
Back to the football and Liverpool's treble-winning season. The other thing I found really interesting about that was how openly he spoke about the fact that at half-time in the UEFA Cup final, they're sort of sat around quite, he said, overconfidently, thinking, we'll just go and score another goal. It's 3-1. This game's almost done and dusted. You don't often hear players speak quite so honestly about that. And I don't think that often happens in games either. But obviously they come off beating Barcelona, as we spoke about. That was the big game, wasn't it? The semi-final. Yeah. And they're 3-1 up in the final. I just think, well, it's done and dusted. And it absolutely wasn't. And how maybe that mentality contributed to it.
I'd love to compare that team talk to the one that they had in Istanbul. Because there's quite a few of the same players there, Haman and Gerrard and stuff. The difference, just sauntering around. So this is done, isn't it? Have we got a Saturday? Is it Charlton? Yeah, it's Charlton. Yeah, what are you doing tonight? Yeah. Lads, it's half time. We don't need to win this game.
Yeah.
And they did, but only just.
Yeah, I mean, I sort of... It's because you, when you're the player, it's not just about the score, is it? I mean, 3-1, but it could have been a hard 3-1. So you can sort of understand if you're, like, you're all going... Jesus, like these are bad. Like this is a bad. We're against these are crap. We're gonna roll them over, and even though they did become complacent in the second half and concede three goals, they still managed to score the goals that won them the thing. So I mean,
kind of right.
They were right. They could basically kind of go to sleep and still win it. But yes, good of him to admit that. A nice candid interview.
So it was a valid overconfidence then?
It seems so, yeah.
Absolutely. Any more on Liverpool's treble-winning season before we go into football fact or football fiction?
I did just want to mention, which we didn't cover, we didn't really touch on the Barcelona game, which the home game was phenomenal, because that again was I think they finished fourth in La Liga, so it wasn't a phenomenal Barca team, but they still had Rivaldo and, you know, Guardiola and players like that. But Guardiola... Sorry, Guardiola. You could compare him to Guardiola. Gary Mack scored the penalty, obviously, and then I think Puyol had been giving him a bit of sledging in the as he prepares to take it, and obviously he scores it, and he just proper gets in his face. You, not in that voice, in a Scottish accent. But.
I genuinely wasn't sure who you were doing an impression of. Then it could have been either of them.
Yeah, I'm not going to try, but just a great moment if you want to watch back his celebration to that. To that goal in Puyol's face, I think is one of the moments. And
there's a really good hoodie you can buy with Steven Gerrard waving his fist in a dejected Pep Guardiola's face.
Brilliant.
It's actually on my shopping list of things to purchase.
When's your birthday?
Wonderful.
10th of April.
Okay, that with a Danny Murphy new poster.
Yes, a new Danny Murphy poster, please.
Okay, let's do a bit of football fact or football fiction. Mark, Alfie and Rob all have a statement, a footballing fact about this treble-winning season, but only one of them is a real fact. The other two are totally made up. They are fiction. My job and your job listening is to work out the fact from the fiction. So we will start with today's guest. In fact, we won't actually. I'll give you a moment. We will start today with Rob. Rob, what have you got?
Well, there's no surprises why I've been given this one, but it's regarding Gary McAllister again. And so sometimes he was quite unpopular among the Liverpool dressing room because he kept telling his teammates to encapsulate, and I quote, the spirit of Leeds. So obviously Gary McAllister was a title winner with Leeds in 91-92, the last champions before it turned into the Premier League.
Absolutely.
And that was similar. So Gary McAllister saw himself at Liverpool as like a Gordon Strachan figure, as Strachan was at Leeds. Strachan was the older head, sort of leading youngsters like David Batty and Gary Speed and setting the example in midfield. And McAllister thought of himself as like that, and he wanted to engender that spirit.
No one wants that. No one wants a load of people just harping back to the old days, do they? Like, oh, that's us now.
I'm fascinated by hearing about David Batty as a youngster. One of these people that I imagine was never a baby. Created a 35-year-old man.
Right, so Gary Mack was unpopular because he kept asking the squad to invoke the spirit of Leeds.
Yes.
Which means a very different thing these days. Yes. Okay, Mark, what have you got?
Okay, so one of Gerard Houllier's travelling traditions, as in what he did for every away game. A lot of managers have these little traditions. His was to eat the same brand of wine gums. I don't know how many different brands there are, but he was insistent on this one. But also argue tactics with Phil Thompson. So a good old row about tactics.
So he'd like to have wine gums and argue about tactics.
Specific brand and yes.
Argument. Who did we speak to on a podcast? It was Graham Stack, wasn't it?
He was.
Who said that on for the Invincible season? Who said that Arsene Wenger used to
confiscate his Werther's originals?
His Werther's originals. That was it on the coach. So I can buy into this idea that there is a kind of superstitious suite that they're involved in. And he also liked to. Would he just have the arguments for the sake of it because it was just part getting everyone motivated and good to go?
No. It was just him and Phil Thompson together. In solitary confinement.
They would just have an argument.
Just get the juices flowing, get the ideas going. But he liked to, you know, encourage Phil Thompson to sort of pick fault in his tactics and get a bit of an argument going.
Thompson told him not to sign McAllister. So they did have disagreements and he would often go above his head.
He's probably worried Phil about Thompson him coming in and saying, invoke the spirit of Leeds, lads. Invoke the spirit of Leeds. Okay, Alfie, what have you got?
Gary McAllister was so popular, he was able to wear his own dressing gown to the changing room, which no other player was allowed to do.
I think for that time, and I said it respectfully, an old stager like Gary Mack, if you want to wear your own dressing gown, if you want to be a little bit comfier, then you should be allowed to. You've achieved enough in your career that if you want to gown it up in the changing room, you should be allowed to do that. I very much believe that could be the case.
We already established he's got scoliosis as well, so you know he needs to look after himself.
Do
you think did he team it up with slippers? Do you think?
I think he probably had a kind of a mug of cocoa, and that was what I frequently always imagined when Roy Hodgson lost his job. I always used to at Liverpool. I used to imagine him crying into his cocoa. About sort of the best moment of his career passed him by, and then probably again. England probably meant a great deal to him as well, and he probably cried again
into his
owl tears into the same
oh man,
the same cracked.
That's a sad thought.
It depends what you think of Roy Hodgson, but also I suppose it is. Yeah.
Right. I to be honest with you, I don't care other than anything of an image of Gary McAllister in a dressing gown in the changing room, and the fact that he had special dispensation to do that. I'm not interested in any other fact or fiction statements other than that one. Alfie, tell me it's true.
I'm afraid that. I made it up. It's false.
Oh, no. That's upsetting.
Sorry.
In that
I'd
case,
like it to be true as well. I think that's probably why I said it.
It may have been.
It may have been true. What it hasn't been reported on.
Unverified. I'm gonna go with Rob.
I'm afraid I have made this up as well.
It's not Mark again, is it?
It is. Ironically, the one time I wasn't telling the truth, you thought I was.
Wait, what?
Huh? No, the one time he was telling the truth, he thought he was.
That makes no sense.
You're a terrible
I'm really good at this. You never get it right.
That doesn't make the statement and sentence you said.
I said the one time I wasn't telling the truth, you thought I was, which is right.
Telling the truth.
I am today, but I said the one time I wasn't telling the truth, you predicted that I was.
No, I didn't predict you were telling the truth.
That's my point. Every time I tell the truth, you don't believe me. But when
I am telling the truth. I still don't believe you.
But I am. I am because these are false. You've already established that.
I basically never believe you is what we're saying.
I don't know what to believe anymore.
Nobody does. Nobody does. But I am telling the truth.
So that's it. Julio likes to have an argument with Phil Thompson.
Yeah. Whilst eating wine gums.
The same brand.
Yeah, a specific kind of.
I wonder how many different brands there are.
You can get knockoff ones in like corner shops, can't you?
Yeah.
They're always a bit tougher.
Oh, okay. Mm. So that adds a bit of texture to it that Tomo is going in to get him his wine gums. He's coming back with knockoff Superman. What you doing?
Oh, yeah, that's what the argument's about. Why don't you get me the? We earn enough money that you can get me with the proper ones here.
Yeah, but they weren't there, gaffer. You know,
Superman brand of wine gums.
And on that wine gum note, we will end things today. Thank you very much, as always, Rob and Mark. Thank you for joining us.
Cheers.
Thank you. And Alfie, good luck with the rest of the tour.
Hey, thanks so much.
Good luck with the impending success for Liverpool.
Thank you so much.
Which might be relevant not in the future, but it is now. So that's all good.
Yeah, thanks very much. There's lots to be really excited about. I hope everybody has a pleasant life.
And on that note, we'll leave things here until the next time on the Broken Metatarsal.